Good morning, Journey Church. Y'all live this morning? Well, my name's Darren Aldridge. This is my wife, Bethany. Man, we're excited, thrilled to be here with you guys. Honored to come and worship with you this morning. Let's stand together this morning, okay? We're going to give our praise to the Lord. He's worthy. guys have a seat for a moment?
Good morning. Today is August 17th. Welcome to Journey Church, a place to embrace the journey, to live for God, love people, and serve the world. We are one church in two locations and would like to welcome both campuses this morning. Each Sunday, be sure to check in on Facebook so your family and friends can know where to join you for worship. And if you are a guest today, welcome. There's a connection card in your seat. Please take the time to fill it out and we'll instruct you on what to do with it at the end of the service today. Again, thanks for being here. This morning, if at any time God speaks to you through a sermon point or scripture, be sure to take note of it and post it later to social networking. There's a good chance someone else needs to hear it too. Recently, our Tifton campus student ministry provided Gatorade and ministered to the Tiff County Middle School football team, and our student director was able to pray for the team and spend some time with them. Be sure to be in prayer for our athletes as the football season starts. If you are looking for a place to call home, we hope that you will consider partnering with us here at Journey as we continue to reach our community and beyond with the gospel. Thanks again for being part of our service today. Remember, you can stay up to date with what is happening at Journey by visiting our website at www.embracethejourney.tv or by liking us on Facebook. Thank you again for joining us today.
Good morning. I'm Bert Crow, discipleship pastor here at Journey. As we come to this time of tithe and offering, I just want to share something with you. I've been rereading a book this last week. It's called The Treasure Principle. It's by Randy Alcorn. I encourage anybody to read it. It's a little short book. It's easy to read. It's the best kind for me anyway. And, you know, as I was reading through it, he has what he calls his treasure principle. The first point of the treasure principle is that whatever you earn here on earth, you can't take it with you. Point two is that you can send it forward. And you know, as we come to this time of tithe and offering, and we remember that our faith coordinates directly with our giving, let us remember that what we're doing is paying forward. Most kind and gracious Heavenly Father, we want to thank you for this church. We want to thank you for this opportunity to come and worship. We want to thank you for the opportunity to pay forward to you and to your kingdom. Lord, we want to thank you, Lord, for all that you've done to bless us. And I pray right now that you place on our minds the things that you've done for us that have blessed us so many times over, especially the opportunity for salvation through Jesus Christ. Lord, I pray that you use whatever is given here to your glory and to your honor and to the advancement of your holy kingdom. In the name of Jesus Christ, I pray. Amen.
life. Our God is able. In His name we overcome. For the Lord our God is able. God is with us. God is on our side. He will make a way far above.
God is for you today. We're all coming in this room today with different stories, different walks of life, different things have happened this week. Some of it good, some of it bad. And we just need to be reminded that God is for us. He's on our side. One of the first songs in the Bible says that God, talks about God being a mighty warrior for His people. It says He fights for His people. You may be here thinking, well, man, I'm not seeing God fight for me today. I don't feel like God's really fighting for me and pulling for me. We have to remember that God is so much bigger than us and what we're going through, and that He knows the end picture, He knows the end result. And we just have to trust God, that He knows what's best for our life. It's amazing that a great God, so great, so powerful, can do anything He wants, but yet He loves us. He wants to have a relationship with us. He knows everything about us. Psalms 139, I love it. One of my favorite psalms. It says that He knit us together in our mother's womb. It says He knows our thoughts from afar off. He knows our rising, our sitting down. He knows our words before we even say it. It's amazing that a great God, a king over the universe, the one who put the stars in place, cares that much about us today, cares that much about you today. He knows your name, He knows where you've been, knows where you're at. I love what Revelation 4 gives us a picture of this God that we're talking about. And John describes what heaven looks like, and it says he looks into heaven and he sees the one on the throne. We know who that one is. It's God, it's Jesus, our our Savior. He's on the throne. It says around the throne, there are these angels, these beings, these created beings that God has made. And it says, and what are they doing? It says they rest day or night, saying, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come." Holy is the only word in the Bible that's mentioned three times, back to back to back, to say how awesome, how other than, how there's no one equal to our God. And so today, listen, we're joining with all of creation, all the church all around the world today. We're joining with what's happening in heaven today. We're not singing a new song to God this morning, man. This is being sung while you were sleeping, while I was sleeping last night. They never rest. Just saying, "Holy, holy, holy is God." And so we're going to join in. We're going to sing that to God. I just invite you this morning to be free in here today. I'm not talking about just lifting your hands. Listen, God doesn't care about your pitch this morning, if you're on key or not, okay? The people behind you or beside you might be thinking that, but hey, that's okay, all right? We're going to just let it rip today, okay? God just wants to hear our praise, okay? Can we do that today? He's worthy, amen? So we're going to sing this together. Wanna be close, close to your side, so heaven is real, your death is a lie. I wanna hear voices of angels above, singing as one, hallelujah. Holy, holy God Almighty, the great I am, who is worthy, none beside thee, God Almighty, the great I am. Here's our prayer today. Wanna be near to your heart, loving the world, hating the dark. I wanna see dry bones living again, singing as one.
Come on, church.
I am, the great I am.
come on, church.
Majesty. There is no power in hell.
Worship him in your heart, in your own voice. Just tell him how great he is in your heart. We're standing before the throne. Just picture the throne. Jesus sitting on a throne. You're just giving your praise to him. Just tell him in your heart how good he is. Just worship him in your way. Before God, our very life, we're laying it before His throne today.
And I surrender all. And I surrender all. All to Thee, my blessed Savior, I surrender.
God, we stand before your throne. God, bare. Lord, your word tells us that all things are laid bare in your sight. God, you see us just as we are. So God, we just bring our, we bring ourselves to you, God, and we lay it before you and say, God, here I am. After what you have done for me, you willingly gave your life up on the cross. You were beaten to the point of death. You took our guilt and our shame. God, as a result of that, God, we gladly give our life to you, our whole life, our future, our plans, our actions, our responses, our families, our work. We lay it before you today, Jesus. We ask for you to speak to our hearts. Continue to speak, Jesus, we pray. In your name, amen. Let y'all have a seat.
Good morning. Look to the person to the left or right of you and go ahead and introduce yourself and say, hey, my name is, go ahead, tell them. Some of you are like, I know your name. I see you at the house every night, right? Hey, and if you're by yourself, go ahead and talk to yourself. That's okay too. And also want to welcome those that are watching online and want to say welcome to you and thank you for joining in with us as we worship together. As Journey Church, one church in two locations here in Tifton, as well as we have a campus in Valdosta, and both campuses were together in this series called Get in the Game. And we believe that this series is going to be a game changer, not only just for a season, but a game changer for the duration of our church until Christ comes. We just believe this is kind of a game changer for us and a defining moment for us as a church, as we talked about last week, as getting in the game and what that looks like. And we talked about the kickoff and how everybody gets excited about the kickoff in sports or in football, right? I mean, we talked about last week, the blood's pumping, you're ready, that first game of the season, you're just ready for the kickoff. And in that, there's different things that we have to prepare for with the kickoff return team. And we applied that to spiritual principles in the life that God calls us to in that first kickoff. There's principles there as we start our journey in following Christ. And this morning, if I was to title this, it would be called First and Ten, New Beginnings. First and Ten, New Beginnings, meaning in the game of football, some of you are going to get schooled in some football for the next few weeks. We're going to be talking a lot of different terminology and in that. But in football, every 10 yards, you get a what? Somebody say it. First down, right? Every 10 yards, you get a new beginning. Every 10 yards, you get this first down. So it may be like first and second down and third and five. And you got to get there to get the first down, or you end up having to punt the ball. But in that, the key is field position and getting it to a place where you can prepare the rest of the team for whatever space you are on the field. And so we're talking about first and 10 in new beginnings and how that applies to our life. So if you have your Bibles, you can turn to the book of Acts chapter 9. We're going to camp out in Acts chapter 9 all day. We won't be moving around anywhere. And we're looking at the conversion of Saul to Paul and what happened in Saul's life and what happened in his life and how that same thing happens in our life. But in football, it's about the 10 yards, right? It's about getting 10 yards to get the next. In fact, Lou Holtz made this comment one time. He said, football is all about 10 yards. He said, keep getting 10 yards, and eventually you will score. He said, keep scoring, and you will win the game. Now, some of you may be like me. Let me go ahead and just have some confession time here. The way I'm driven, like, it's first and 10, and I want to throw the Hail Mary. Like, every play, I want to get 50 yards in one play every time. I mean, it's true even in reality when I'm playing some PS2 or PS3 with some kids and we're playing college football. Like, every game, some of you are like, old school, PS2 is like 10 years ago. I heard it right here. Listen, hey, that's okay. Jesus loves you too. But listen, hey, don't hate on the old school. Hey, even on like first down, like I'm throwing Hail Mary every time and they're like, Benji, if you're going to win the game, you got to change it up a little bit. I mean, anybody else like that in life? Like, you want the end result immediately? Anybody go ahead and confess, okay? We want the end result, so we like want to throw long every time instead of listening to the plays 10 yards at a time. And a lot of time, that's how God works, right? It's 10 yards, it's a new beginning. You take the next 10 yards, it's a new beginning. You take the next 10 and you follow me. And we're going to apply this principle to the life of Saul. So let's look at spiritual first and 10 reminders from a spiritual aspect. We've talked about it from football. Let's look at it from the spiritual aspect of the first and 10 reminders. Number one is this: our best efforts are not good enough. You need to write that down. Our best efforts are not good enough. Look to the person to the left or right of you and say, you're not good enough. Go ahead, tell them. No matter how hard we work in our flesh, we will never be good enough to please a holy God. With no amount of work that we try to accomplish in our own flesh, will we please God. No amount of good that you and I can do to be made right with a holy God. It's only through Jesus, it's only through the shedding of his blood that sacrifice has been made that you and I can be redeemed, that you and I can have a relationship with Christ. And listen, our best efforts are not good enough. The same principle applies on the field. We've seen it before, right? Perhaps one of your favorite teams has had or experienced this. You can have the best running back in the world. I mean, he can be, top notch, number one in the country. But if you don't have an offensive line to block for him, you can have a quarterback that has accuracy like nobody's business. But if you don't have anybody blocking for him, he's not going to accomplish much. He may get a little bit on his own, but not far. Because his best efforts are not good enough on that field alone. But with the team working together, then he's able to make progress and the team is able to get somewhere. The same is true with us. Listen, in our flesh, we cannot do this alone. But as part of the family of God, when we're connected in with Christ and his power, then we're able to make progress and see things happen. But our best efforts will not be good enough. Acts chapter 9, verses 1 through 4. Look with me. Meanwhile, Saul was still breathing out murderous threats against the Lord's disciples. He went to the high priest and asked him for letters to the synagogues in Damascus, so that if he found any there who belonged to the way, meaning those that were Christ's followers, the way, whether men or women, he might take them as prisoners to Jerusalem. As he neared Damascus on his journey, suddenly a light from heaven flashed around him. He fell to the ground, and he heard a voice say to him, Saul, Saul, why do you persecute me? He says, why are you doing this? You see, Saul was a religious man. Saul followed these rules, and he was a religious man, and he thought it was his duty to go out and find these people that were the way, that were following Christ, that he would go out and find them and put them in prison and was sending out these murderous threats, that he was hunting them down. He was a very religious man, but he was wrong in his religion. He had knowledge. He understood Scripture in the Old Testament as far as, I mean, he had it. He had it down pat, probably better even than some of the disciples in understanding the Old Testament. His issue was with the New Testament and with the Messiah and with Jesus and who he claimed to be. And even though Saul was a religious man, even though Saul was a descendant of Abraham, he was still not a child of God. So let me translate that to modern day. Your mom and dad can be Sunday school teachers. You can come from a generation of a family of pastors. You can have someone that's been in church their whole life. That does not make you right with God. Let me say this. You could have been in church for 20 years, and the person beside you, this is their first Sunday. And that makes you no more right with God than the person beside you. Because it's only through Jesus that we're made right. There's no amount of religious activity that we can perform here today in order to balance the scales to make us right with a holy God. Saul was very knowledgeable of the Scriptures. It's not what you know, but it's what? Who you know. It's not about the knowledge as much as it is the relationship. Now, therefore, we should know His Word and apply it to our lives. And we'll get to that in a minute. But it's about the relationship. It doesn't matter how educated you are. It doesn't matter how you stack up against the other players. In sports, we have a tendency, well, I'm second string, or I'm first string, or they're third string. And we stack ourselves up according to our skill level and according to how we're able to play, and that's who we put on the field. But listen to me, it doesn't matter how you stack up against others in the room when it comes to your gifts and your talents or your education or anything else. What matters is how you stack up to a holy God. And the Bible says, without Him in our lives, without a repentance and confessing Him as Lord, I mean, listen, our works are like filthy rags, Scripture says. It's only through the power of Christ that can work within us that we can see things happen. It's not in our best efforts. Our best efforts will never be good enough. Number two is this. Not only are our best efforts aren't good enough, but number two is we need to run the play that God calls. You and I have to run the play that God gives us. Last week we used the illustration, but in football, there's always the coach up top in the press box. He sees the field, he's calling the plays. Then the quarterback's down on the field and he's calling that play out. He can't see the entire field. He sees what's about to happen, but it's hard for him to see everything. And he's trusting the call that's been given to him from up top in order to carry that out on the field. And the same is true with God, how He sees the plays in our life. He sees the field and He calls the plays. And there's a lot of times we don't understand it, but we have to trust in that. And we have to be willing to run the play that God calls. Verse 4 and following. Or let's go to verse 5. "Who are you, Lord?" Saul asked. "I am Jesus, whom you are persecuting. Now get up and go into the city, and you will be told what you must do." The men traveling with Saul stood there speechless. They heard the sound, but did not see anyone. Saul got up from the ground, but when he opened his eyes, he could see nothing. So they led him by the hand into Damascus, and for 3 days he was blind and could not eat or drink anything. So finally, God gets his attention and he blinds him. I mean, he's right there in that moment and he says, "This is what I want you to do. This is where I want you to go." And it was the first time in Saul's life that he listened to the right coach, that he listened to the game plan that God had for him. And it was the first time that he showed obedience to the one and only true God. And he followed through with what the Lord was telling him to do. Now, my question this morning is this. Who are you taking calls from? Are you taking calls from what other people think about you? and you're allowing them to call the plays in your life. Now listen, let me say this. I'm not talking about authority in your work, like my boss told me I had to be there at 9, but I don't care. I'm going to go, and that's not what I'm talking about, okay? Don't go be like, I'm set free, I can do what I want. No, listen. You know what I'm talking about. Who are you taking calls from? Are you calling the shots? This is my life. I get one shot at it. I call the shots. Who's calling the shots in your life? Now, I want you to picture this. When God struck Saul down and he heard his voice, Scripture says when he got up, he was blind. And for the next 3 days, he was not able to see. Why do you think this happened? Picture this. What is the last thing he sees before he's blind? Jesus. And then for the next 3 days, he can't focus on anything else because the last thing he saw was Jesus. And there are times in our lives where we get caught up by everything else that's going on in our life, and Jesus says, you need to focus back in on the one who's calling the shots. And you need to get focused back in on me. This past week, I was up at the middle school teaching PE, and on Friday, like, Friday's the big, like, kids just go nuts on Friday. They're ready to get home and all that, so we decided to let them play war ball on Friday. And so, how many know what war ball is? All right, you're telling your age. Some of the younger ones in here may know what that is. All right, so basically, it's like dodgeball, and we have these cones set up with tennis balls, and the kids have to knock down all three tennis balls off the cones, and when they do, they win, and they can't cross half-court line. So anyway, being the good, you know, teacher that I was going to be, I had them all on the side, and I was like, you here, you here, you here, you here. I didn't want anybody getting left out, so I just picked the teams for them. Well, when I stood back and looked at both walls, I was like, I have messed up. I, like, totally stacked this team over here with all the big kids, like, every one of them. I mean, and the other ones over here were, like, trembling, like, this is not going to be good for us. And so, and I realized it, so I sat back and I said, okay, we'll just see how it plays out. So the first game was over, like, pretty quick. I mean, just in a matter of about 2 minutes, the game was over. And then I made those kids do push-ups. Like, I made them, like, do some exercise if they lost. Well, game two ended in about another 2 or 3 minutes, and I had to make these kids do exercises again. I'm like, gosh, I'm a terrible teacher. Like, these kids are going to get all the exercise. These kids are going to get a victory. These kids are going to feel like losers, and I'm going to ruin their life. So I was trying to figure out how to fix this situation. So I pulled all these kids together in a huddle, and they were over there, the big guys. They had, you know, stacked team. I pulled them together and said, here's what I want you to do. When I blow the whistle, you just hang tight. Don't move. Let them throw all of their balls across the line, and you pick them all up. And they were like, we're going to get killed, coach. I was like, no, just dodge it, whatever you got to do. Take one for the team. Listen, just hang in there, and once all of you, and there's like 27 balls on the court. Once you have all of them, pick a cone, count the three, and every one of you release your ball at the same time towards that cone. Somebody's got to hit it. Like, it's going to happen. And so, anyway, called the game. I mean, within a matter of minutes, all the balls had crossed over the line, and these kids realized, oh, snap. Like, they have all the balls. And so, when they released it, I mean, they crushed the next three games they won. They beat the bigger team because what? They had a plan. They were listening to someone who was sitting back watching the whole thing. And some of us in life, that's how we live. We go aimlessly just trying to make it day to day when there's a plan, and there should be some intentionality of how we live our lives and how we respond. And we need to listen to God's plan and what he calls us to do. And God took Saul's focus off of the world and placed it on him. And for 3 days, he had time to get that before he was able to see. And the same is true with us. We need to take our focus off of this world when we get in the game. And we need to focus in on the game plan that God has for us. Number three, quickly, is a first and 10 makes our huddles sweeter. A first and 10 makes our huddles sweeter. Look with me at verses 10 through 19. In Damascus, there was a disciple named Ananias. The Lord called to him in a vision. Ananias, yes, Lord, he answered. The Lord said to him, go to the house of Judas on Straight Street and ask for a man from Tarsus named Saul, for he is praying. And in a vision, he has seen a man named Ananias come and place his hand on him to restore his sight. Lord, Ananias answered, I have heard many reports about this man and all the harm he has done to your saints in Jerusalem. And he has come here with authority from the chief priest to arrest all who call on your name. But the Lord said to Ananias, go, this man is my chosen instrument to carry my name before the Gentiles and their kings and before the people of Israel. And I will show him how much he must suffer for my name. And we continue. Then Ananias went to the house, entered, placing his hands on Saul. He said, Brother Saul, the Lord Jesus who appeared to you on the road as you were coming here has sent me here so that you may see again and be filled with the Holy Spirit. Immediately something like scales fell from Saul's eyes and he could see again. He got up and was baptized. And after taking some food, he regained his strength. Now my point number three, first and ten, makes our huddles sweeter, is this. Is any time you're in a game and you get that first and ten, it just makes things sweeter. It's like, okay, we got 10 yards, let's go again. Let's regroup and let's go again. And the same spiritually, when we get the first and ten, for Saul, this was a first and ten moment. This was a new start for him from his past. This was a new way for him to surrender his life to Christ. And in that moment, Paul biblically became brothers with Ananias in the same calling that God had on their life to proclaim the gospel. In fact, in verse 19, Paul spent some time huddling with the disciples in Damascus, hanging out there with the apostles and those around, and he was huddling, and it made the team sweeter because, listen, the one who is chasing them is now the one who is gathering them. The one who is attacking them is now on their side, helping them go out and reach others. And so for Saul, he became a Christ follower. It was his new start. It was his first and ten. Now he's pursuing with the gospel to take it to the city and take it to the people there. And it made the huddle sweeter. And let me say this, when we as a church and we see people come to know Christ and they surrendered their life to Jesus, in the same way, we should celebrate. We should be excited because the huddle gets sweeter. Every time we reach somebody far from God with the gospel and they become part of our family, the huddle needs to get sweeter. If it does not get sweeter to you, then you need to ask yourself the question, am I part of the huddle to begin with? It should get sweeter. Every time we reach someone with the gospel, as we grow in numbers to be able to go out and to reach others, it should get sweeter. Now, I want you to turn to your neighbor and say something, but you need to listen to instructions because it's going to be important how you respond to this. So if you're married, wait till I say go. If you're married, you can look to your spouse and say, you make my huddle sweeter. Now, hold on. If you're married and your spouse is not here, this could get really awkward. So follow me. If you're married and your spouse isn't here, just look around and say, hey, bro, you make the huddle sweeter. Or, hey, sister, you make the huddle sweeter. If you're single, this is your opportunity. You see, you know, someone and you say, hey, you could make my huddle sweeter. All right, so listen, like, what kind of preacher? Listen, you need to meet him in church anyway. So, all right, here we go. 1, 2, 3, go ahead, tell him. Go ahead. Now, if her father is sitting beside her, that might not be the wisest thing to do. I'm giving you a warning there. Our huddle needs to be sweeter as we see people come to know Christ. Number four is this, quickly. A first and ten secures a new start. It secures a new start. Look at verse 17 with me. Then Ananias went into the house, entered it, placing his hands on Saul. He said, Brother Saul, the Lord Jesus who appeared to you on the road as you were coming here has sent me so that you may see again and be filled with the Holy Spirit. In the same encounter that Saul had, in some way should be the same encounter that every one of us as Christ followers have had. Where God calls us out and says, I've chosen you. I'm calling you. The Holy Spirit convicts us of our sin. We need to repent and confess Him as Lord and have a new start. There's something about a new start. When you've messed things up, there's something about having a second chance. You know, as Christ followers, we get a new start. We get a second chance. It's called grace and forgiveness. And we should show that to others as well. And there's something about first and tens that secures a new start on the field. You may have messed up, may have made some mistakes, but it's a new possession. It's a new first down. Let's roll. Let's go with it. Look at verse 22 with me. And in verse 22, Scripture says, "Yet Saul grew more and more powerful and baffled the Jews living in Damascus by proving that Jesus is the Christ." Let me tell you what was happening here. Saul radically got changed in this moment. And now no longer was he persecuting and trying to kill them and put them in prison, but now he's trying to reach them with this gospel. And Saul was a very smart man and a very intelligent man, but what was more persuasive than his intelligence was his transformed life. What was more important than his knowledge was the fact that his life had completely changed, and it was evident by the life that he lived. You go down in verse 27, and I don't have time to read all this. I'll just move to 27. And in verse 27 it says, "But Barnabas took him and brought him to the apostles. He told them how Saul on his journey had seen the Lord, and that the Lord had spoken to him, and now, and how in Damascus he had preached fiercely in the name of Jesus." Let me quickly explain what was going on. The disciples were still concerned about this. Even though Saul was now preaching the gospel and going and telling others, the disciples were still in the corner going, I still don't know about this. This guy was the one that was after us to kill us, to put us in prison, and now he's on our team? And Barnabas comes along, and Barnabas pulls him into the group, the scripture says. Barnabas comes in and says, he bridges the gap and says, "Hey, no, this guy's legit." And he brings him into the group and helps him out. So many times in our churches, someone gives their life to Christ, and we have our huddle over here, and we're afraid to invite them in the huddle. We're afraid to be the Barnabas that bridges that gap and brings them into the community and says, "Come on." And so many times we look and we say, "Well, they got a past. I just don't know that that's legit. I don't know that that's real." Who are you to judge? What has God done for you? How's he saved you? And he can do that for others. And we need to be the Barnabas that loves others and brings other people in. And listen, we are only as strong as our weakest link. In football, you're only as strong as your weakest link. If there's a weak link in the line, that defense will penetrate it every time. And the same is true with our church family. We are as strong as our weakest link, and we need to bring those around us that are weak or struggling, and we need to bring them in, and we need to love on them. That's part of our live for God, love people, and serve the world. But first and ten is a new beginning. It's for a new start. And God never says that he'll spare us from hardships and trials. I think it's evident in Saul's conversion as Paul and the life that he lived. But he promises that he'll see us through it, not that he'll spare us from it. And with that being true, we need all the support we can get in our huddles. We need all the support we can get with our family. And we need to bring others in when they convert to Christ or surrender their life to him. And we need to love on them and show Christ's likeness to them in the way that we live. And my last point is this, is first and ten helps the whole team. A first and ten helps the whole team. Look with me at verse 26 and following. It says, "When he came to Jerusalem, he tried to join the disciples, but they were all afraid, not believing that he was really a disciple." Here's where they were judging. They were questioning. "But Barnabas took him, brought him to the apostles. He told them how Saul on his journey had seen the Lord, and that the Lord had spoken to him, and how in Damascus he had preached fiercely in the name of Jesus. So Saul stayed with them and moved about freely in Jerusalem, speaking boldly in the name of the Lord. He talked and debated with the Greeks and Jews, but they tried to kill him. When the brothers learned of this, they took him down to Caesarea and sent him off to Tarsus. Then the church throughout Judea, Galilee, and Samaria enjoyed a time of peace. Follow me. It was strengthened and encouraged by the Holy Spirit, and it grew in numbers, living in the fear of the Lord. Meaning, when there's a first and ten, when there's a new start, when there's a new beginning, when someone else is added to the family, it helps the whole team. In football, every time there's a first and ten, it not only helps those that are on the field in that moment, but it helps others. It helps the field goal unit when they come out, the closer they can get. It helps them to be able to make that kick. It helps the punter be able to adjust where he needs to get when he punts the ball. It helps everybody on the team because we're one unit. And the same is true with the church. As we see people added to the family, people are added to the huddle, and we see first and tens take place every Sunday. We see people surrendering their life to Christ. It should make the huddle sweeter. You know, it helps the whole team because it's given a new start. It helps everybody. You know, and as I said earlier, there's something about new starts. There's something about new opportunities. There's something about giving a second chance at life, giving a second chance at whatever it may be. When you receive that grace and that mercy and that forgiveness. And what happens in football is the quarterback may throw an interception, running back may fumble the ball, lineman may slip and let somebody through, whatever it may be, it may make a mistake. But when they come back together, it's a first and ten again. And on that next possession, he comes in and goes, "Listen, guys, I dropped the ball. I made a bad call. It's first and ten. It's a new possession. Let's go." And the same is true in our spiritual walk. Some of you in here, you've dropped the ball. You've made some mistakes. You threw an interception. You didn't block where you needed to, whatever it may be, whatever you may be going through. And the same God who had an encounter with Saul is the same God this morning in this moment that wants to have an encounter with you and wants to give you forgiveness and mercy. But you've got to turn to him, surrender to him, repent of your sins, confess him as Lord. Maybe you're a Christ follower, but you've just dropped the ball and it's time to get back on track. With every head bowed and every eye closed, no one's looking around, you would say, "Pastor Benji, that's where I'm at. I desire to surrender my life to Jesus this morning. I desire to confess him as Lord." And the Holy Spirit is tugging your heart right now. In the same encounter, the same God that entered Saul's life is wanting to enter your life right now. Saul had a past. I mean, you talk about a past, church. It takes years to build a reputation, and it takes a moment to destroy it. Some of you can testify to that. But Saul had years of a reputation that was not good. And he had a moment, a defining moment, where he encountered God and altered his life for eternity. Ended up writing a majority of the New Testament. What does God want to do with you this morning? No one's looking around. If right now, if that's a decision you need to make, I want to pray for you. No one's looking around. On the count of three, just simply raise your hand and say, "God's speaking to my heart this morning, and I need to surrender my life to Jesus. I need to confess him as Lord." It's a new start. It's a first and ten for you right now. No one's looking around. One, two, three. Go ahead. Raise your hands. Thank you for raising your hands. Thank you for raising your hands. I don't want to miss you. Thank you for raising your hands. Over here on the right-hand side, I see it. Thank you for raising your hand. You can put it down. Any others in the back? Thank you. You can put your hands down. I see your hands in the back. Any others? Thank you over here on the left, up front. I see your hands. Thank you. Amen. Father, I pray right now, God, for those that you're working on their heart, God, and right now they're in a moment of surrender. They're in a moment of giving their life to you. And Lord, we rejoice in that and we celebrate in that, God, and we thankful for what's happening. And Lord, may we be a church of Barnabases that take them in and God and begin to help them in their journey. Lord, that's who you've called us to be. Father, I pray for others in here that have dropped the ball, that have made mistakes, but they know they're on the right path. They know that they're Christ followers, but they just have been calling audibles. They've been making the wrong calls and not following the plan that you have for their lives. And so, Father, may we get back focused where we need to be. And Lord, may we trust in you. And Lord, some people are down and out, and Lord, they can't see it. God, they're struggling even this morning. And Lord, we know that even with the disciples, Lord, when you were placed on the cross and one day went by, and another day went by, and another day went by, and they were wondering, what's going on? What are we going to do next? And on that third day, Scripture says that you rose again, and you conquered the grave, and you set us free. And Father, may we be set free this morning. Some of us are down and out, Lord. We don't see it. Lord, it's third down and long. But God, we're going to trust in you. We're going to trust in Christ alone. And we're going to worship you regardless of the storm, regardless of the trial. God, we're going to trust in you, knowing that you'll see us through it. And we declared that this morning as the body of Christ. For it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's stand to our feet and give the Lord a shout and a clap of hand praise for what he's done in this place this morning.
In Christ alone, my hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, why fears are still when striving cease. My comforter, my all in all, here in the love of Christ I stand. Oh.
up, church. Give the Lord praise. Come on. Give a shout of praise to God.
You guys can be seated for just a moment. And while you're seated, if you'll take a connection card around you. And several of you made spiritual decisions this morning. And we want to help you on that journey. If you take a moment to fill that out, it's on the bottom. It says, My Spiritual Journey. Wherever you are, we want to connect with you on that and help you in any way we can. If you're a first or second time guest, also be sure to fill this out for us. We'd love to have information to be able to connect. And any questions that you have about the church, we'd love to help answer that. On the backside, next Sunday after this service, the 11 o'clock service next Sunday, we're having a membership lunch. If you desire to be a part of that and just come in here, listen, there's no if you come and say, hey, this isn't for me, that's great. We'd love to have you come and at least hear about our church, who we are, what we believe. And then if you feel that you align with the vision that God's called us to, we would love to have you join and be a part of our family. And you can do that by simply on the bottom of this card somewhere under prayer requests, just put your name and put membership lunch and how many people's coming with you. If it's three of you or four of you, if you're a family of five, whatever, put that down because we'll be providing lunch for you immediately after church for that. And it'll take about 30 to 45 minutes to go through that. And we'd love to be able to help connect you in that. So be sure to do that and turn that in. On the right-hand side of the door, there's a basket. Just drop those in the basket. We would love to have you guys come back tonight at 8:30, 8:45. You can come here and watch the Rising Star show tonight. The top six perform. Our worship pastor is one of those. If he makes it through tonight, the finale, the very end of the show is next Sunday, and we'll do a big shindig right here for that at our church. But for tonight, we're just going to provide coffee. No desserts, just providing coffee. Come get a cup of coffee, sit right here, bring your phone, and be able to swipe right as we vote for Pastor Austin tonight as he continues to perform in this show. And we'd like to say thanks to Darren and Bethany for being here tonight. It's an honor to have them. They serve at a church plant over in Blackshear called Bridge Community Church, and they serve over there, and also used to serve with our executive pastor, Pastor Ronnie, when he was over in Jamestown. And so there's some ties there, and we're so thankful that they could be here this morning. You guys be blessed. Spend time with your family. Join us tonight right here for an hour with a cup of coffee and hang out with us. You'll have a good time if you come back. We'll see you next week. Invite somebody to come get in the game. Be blessed. Thank y'all.